my name's Claire.
And my name's Corey.
We're academic librarians at two different state colleges here in Florida, and we're here today to talk about how superheroes, which all librarians are, need super organization.
And super planning.
So one of the things that we want you to consider today for our presentation is what isn't working in your planning and organization needs right now. You might find that you have trouble balancing home and work life. You might find that really dedicating yourself to a long-term project isn't happening. You're overwhelmed by the daily demands.
And the most important thing to keep in mind is when you're thinking about all this, is if something hits your brain and goes, that absolutely is not working, you need to acknowledge that, because there are so many planners out there, both physical planners and planner people, who keep doing something that just does not work because they think they should do it.
So we're really about functionality. We're going to cover a bunch of different stuff, a bunch of different tools, and hopefully there's something you can use.
All right, so this is one of my favorite quotes. I don't rise and shine, I caffeinate and hope for the best. How many people out there can relate to this? Raise your hand.
Yeah, me too. So a lot of us have trouble getting started and getting going, and that is absolutely a reality. But one of the things I really want to talk about and I'm passionate about is the myths of productivity.
Oh, yes.
So there are a lot of people who fall into one of these traps. My least favorite is the I'm not an organized person. Organization is not innate. Mm-hmm. Organization is learned and practiced. It's something you do, not something you inherently are. What I fall into personally is if I were more organized, I could get everything done. Unfortunately, I've discovered that there are still only 24 hours mm-hmm. in a day, and I'm technically only supposed to be working for 8 of those. Mm-hmm. Finally, I'm not prone to this, but some people are.
Yeah, I'm not either.
But I only deal with the important things. And one of the things that you find the more you start planning is the more planning you can do, the fewer emergencies you have to deal with, because things get taken care of when they're itty-bitty problems rather than giant fires.
Exactly. And the whole, I'm just lazy. No, you're not. You're not lazy.
You might be lazy, but it's equally likely
that you may just lack the motivation or fear of looking at what you need to do. If I make a list, how many people have ever made that master to-do list of every single little thing you have ever had to do, whether it's personal, work, or let's be crazy, both, combine the list. How many people are paralyzed at that very thought? Yeah, sometimes it's just the number of tasks that seem overwhelming. Another one is trouble with changing from one thing to another. Transitions really are hard. When it comes to, okay, well, I'm working on this project, but I need to stop and transition to the next part of this project, to a different project, whether it's something around the house, or for me right now, it's something at work because I'm juggling multiple things. I do have a hard time transitioning sometimes at work. I really do. Fear of failure. If I don't look at it, I can't fail at it. This also falls under the perfectionism mentality of if I don't or I can't stop, I'll never be finished until it's perfect.
And perfect is the enemy of done.
Yes.
Embracing good enough is an amazing thing.
Inertia, the inertia of doing nothing. Yes, sometimes it really is. Just getting started, and maybe the getting started is taking that one task and breaking it down into smaller baby steps. I know I have to do that with projects here at work, or you know, for those of you that are trying to apply this to your personal life, we're redoing the front of our house right now, and if I just write down on my to-do list redo front of house, well, that includes pull up the frog pond, pull up the landscaping blocks, pull out all the bushes, get a quote for a screen room. It involves like a dozen other different steps.
And that can be really overwhelming. Mm-hmm. I personally fool myself into working on giant projects by telling myself I only have to work on it for 10 minutes today.
Yeah.
And it's amazing how many things you can get done in 10 minutes.
Yeah. And then just to one last kickoff of the inertia of doing, not knowing where to start. So that big project that you have no idea where to start, that's where the baby, breaking it down into the baby steps comes from. Sometimes, I don't always do this. Sometimes I'll write the steps down in the order that they need to be done. Sometimes I'll just write them down to get them out of my head and I'll cross them off as I get them done.
And if you have no idea how to break a big task down into little steps, it's okay. There are tools out there that are designed to help you do that. We're going to talk about a few of them. So it's a learned behavior. Just because you don't know how to do it right now doesn't mean you won't learn. All right, so let's talk a little bit about how I got into organizing, or rather, got from being a completely unorganized mess in high school. I skated through high school by the grace of some teachers and a fair amount of smarts, but I was an organizational black hole disaster. My binders did look like that. And then I got into a pretty rigorous college, and suddenly my giant pile of all the stuff was not cutting it anymore. So I got a basic planner. Then I went on to graduate school. So I was a full-time graduate school student while working part-time as well. And I used the very early iteration of Google Calendar. This is how long ago that was. That was still in beta at the time. And a paper planner and a giant to-do list. And then I started working full-time. And I was using Google calendars and Outlook calendars and a huge list of to-dos, and I was totally overwhelmed. I couldn't keep track of things. I was really drowning in all of the things that needed to happen. So this is actually where Corey came in. I just started using what I called my Post-it note empire. It was a manila folder that I divided with some pretty pieces of paper into sections. And the idea was that high priority things would go in one corner and low priority things in another corner, and the kind of deep freeze area for stuff I was someday going to get to. And so we were at a conference and I opened up my Post-it note organizer, waiting for the presentation to start, and Corey went,
"What is that?"
And that's how we met. We bonded over our love of Post-it notes and organization.
To this day, we exchange different cool Post-it notes that we find.
So the great thing about the Post-it note empire was, instead of an immovable list of objects, I had Post-it notes. I could change things around without having to endlessly recopy the to-do list. It also gave me some flexibility. If I knew I was going to have a rough week, I could move things to lower priority. But it didn't end up it wasn't quite enough structure. I had too many projects, especially too many complicated, involved, multi-step projects. It also involved me like opening up this folder and making decisions every single day on what I was going to work in. And that was taking a lot of brain power and kind of effort to keep on top of. Finally, I didn't really have a good way to follow up or to schedule events in advance. So I decided I was going to make a planner. Now, this is partially because I'm a cheapskate and I did not want to buy a very fancy $40 planner if I didn't know if it was going to work. So I made a really simple planner in Publisher. I decorated it with stickers and tape so it was pretty. That's an essential part of my planning process, is making sure it's pretty, because then I am not full of despair when I look at my list of to-dos. You can see here that it's half kind of calendar. It's 8 to 9. That's my standard working hours. And it also has a kind of blank area where my Post-it notes come to hang out. So I can move things around. I can be like, okay, on Monday I am absolutely going to work on this QEP project. And it's there. And if I get a little bit done, but it's not totally done, I can move it to the next week and know that on Tuesday of next week I'm going to work on the QEP. So it gave me a way to schedule things out nicely. But it still wasn't quite enough. I needed another plan. So this is where a tool called the Emergent Task Planner. This is a free printable. You can find it online, and we link to it at the end of our presentation. It's actually made for people who do time blocking, which is not at all how I use it. I use it as a method of tracking my work. What are my top three or four or five priorities, and how much time does it actually take me to get those items done? How much time does it take me to prep for a library instruction session? I had no idea before I started doing this. It also gives me a lot of room to put my post-it notes, right? I can move them from my to-do list right onto my, this is what I'm doing today. And it saved my butt when the college closed early when Hurricane Irma came into town. You may not know, but Hurricane Irma came across Florida, and a lot of us, including me, our college was closed for 2 weeks. When I came back, I'd been without power for most of a week. I had no idea what I had done with anything. I didn't know what projects were started or finished or anything. And I went through the past 2 weeks of these emergent tasks planners, and suddenly I knew exactly where I was on every single project. It's pretty great.
And now my turn. Okay, so my origin story is a little different. Anybody that follows me on YouTube, yes, I do have a YouTube channel where I talk about all the different planning systems I have tried over the last 3 years. It's easier to actually say what systems I did not try versus what I did. But my system, whereas Claire's system is more work-based, I have a combined system. My personal planner also has work stuff in it, but I also have a separate notebook. This is not a planner, it's just my project stuff for work that stays at work. But my origin story, we have to go personal. So yeah, work stays at work, personal goes with me everywhere, and there are flex binders galore. But I've tried everything. I did Franklin Covey, traveler's notebooks, bullet journaling, which I would do it in a ringed binder, not a bound book. Day timer, which is similar to Franklin Covey. The passion planner, which that is also a very good planner. And then I ended up making a custom setup. It's the same book, it's just, Of course the clicker doesn't want to work for me right now. That cover is underneath this one. You just can't see it. Haha. See what I mean by custom? So, what I do for work though, what is in this monster is my master task list of everything I have to do. Anytime my director gives me a project, I give myself a project, I need to be reminded about something that another librarian needs done, like we're having an ebook issue right now. I do it in a bullet journal style. I have a table of contents. My favorite section is what I call project stew. That is where every single project and its information sheet, if you will, are. So I actually just finished up a long-term project. It's called the core list. The RCL core list, some of you may know what I'm talking about, where I was checking this very, very large list against our entire print collection and ebook collection, actually. And it took breaking down the project into manageable sections. I just finished it. The P's, which is the literature section, we use Library of Congress, is the largest section in our collection. So, in order just to get me through this large section, I would give myself a few pages a day just to get through. because how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. But bigger projects like collection development or getting ready for this presentation at FLA, they have their own sections in my book. I also have a monthly task list. This is a growing list, a living document, where I start at the beginning of our budget year. Our budget year runs July 1st to June 30th, and each month I will write in there what I have to do each month. And as I think of new things or things need to be changed, like I said, it's a living document, I have it. And this has been so great since in the last couple of months, my job duties have changed a little bit and I'm now doing tasks that I didn't have to do before, like statistics, whether they be purchasing statistics or orientation statistics. So things like that. My week at a glance. I personally, Claire likes using the horizontal style. I personally love the vertical style, mainly because that gives me the opportunity to look at, okay, I work from 7:30 to 4 each day, and then I get to see all the little lines from 4:30 to 9-ish, which is about when I start getting ready for bed. And that gives me the ability to limit myself and limit the number of things I give myself to do in the evening, because I am really bad about this. If I don't, and this includes writing down in the 4 to 4:30 slot, work to home. I have to write in my travel time because I'm so bad, I will write down a task in there. It's like, hey, dummy, you can't do that right then. You're driving. So everybody has their thing, but I love the vertical because I get, to me, it makes sense. All right, potential organization needs.
So these are some needs that we've identified that are common among organizations. For me, tracking time is a huge deal. The Emergent Task Planner lets me see how much of my time is going to what project. I discovered that especially on Monday morning, it's 2 hours to get through my email. I just have to take that off the top of my day. My working time in a standard Monday is 2 hours for an email, 6 hours for everything else.
Scheduling appointments and meetings. That may sound similar to tracking time, but for me, it's currently, with our current reference desk schedule, I spend half my day on the reference desk. Now that's going to change in a few weeks, which is fine. But for me, it's knowing that I can write it on my daily column. I will highlight not only the hours I am at work, but I will block out when I am on the reference desk. That way, if I have to make an appointment, a doctor's appointment or something, and I have to choose a time I'm on the reference desk, I know that, and I can ask a coworker or trade shifts with a coworker so that the reference desk isn't left unstaffed.
Projects, large or complex projects, which I've been doing an increasing number of, need a ton of structure. So whether this is part of your planning, your planner, or just a larger part of your project organization, realizing how much structure you need for a specific project is pretty important.
Tracking routine tasks like self-care and all that. That may sound not appropriate for work, but in reality, taking care of yourself, even if it's something as simple as making sure you take your vitamins every day, getting out of the office and going for a walk around the building or around campus if you work at a school, it's making sure, doing yoga at night, whatever. It's making sure that you are at your best, that you are being your best self. Because when you take care of yourself outside of work, it makes you a better employee. It really does.
Follow-up has been a huge part of my planning and organization system. I'm working a lot on large collaborative projects, and I need to make sure that people are getting me their pieces of the project as we go. So I schedule when I'm going to follow up. I have a master checklist of who needs to do what and whether or not they've done it. It's a big part of my planning system.
To jump over to prioritizing, I know we were doing the little zigzaggy thing, but prioritizing, this is something you learn. It's just like being organized. It's something that I have learned recently. I would make myself a list of 10 to 20 items to try to do in a given weekend. Just, yeah, I know. And it caused some issues, to be perfectly honest. And it took learning to prioritize, and I will get more into that in a few slides. And I'll show you the system I use, but you can do anything, but you can't do everything. That has been the biggest lesson for me, and learning to prioritize and figure out what do you really need to get done versus what do you want to get done.
Minutia wrangling. This takes up a surprisingly large amount of time. Putting in a work order about the leak in the ceiling, making sure that the filter on the circulation count gate gets changed on a regular basis. There are a lot of things that individually take up maybe 3 minutes of my time, but they've got to get done. So I spend a fair amount of time scheduling and just taking care of the minutia. So don't feel like it's because it's a little tiny task that it's not worth putting in your planning or planner system.
One trusted
place. Yes, the one trusted place. So even if you don't like any of the planner layouts we show you, if you can't find anything you like, honestly, everybody can benefit from the one trusted place idea. Mm-hmm. I think David Allen started it in Getting
Yes.
Things Done. But the idea is if you have one dedicated location where all of your stuff is, you no longer waste time going, where is it? Before I switched over to one place, I'm on different campuses, I'm on the reference desk, I'm in my office, I was running back and forth trying to find the files I needed to work on a project. To get started on a project was 15 minutes of frantically going through my filing cabinet going, where the heck is it? Now everything is in a giant three-ring binder, and that's what I use.
She has a giant three-ring binder. I have a flex binder, and for the same reason. Everything, every project that I work on, whether it's in my office or at the reference desk, I don't have to go between campuses, lucky me, but I know all the paperwork I need for everything is in this black binder.
And your trusted place can also be digital. Don't be afraid of the digital solution. I know people who use OneDrive is their one place. Everything they need is in OneDrive. All they need to do is log into OneDrive and they are ready to roll. Some people use Google Drive for that. Whatever works for you.
Yes, project planning techniques. Now, I am a fan of the mind map. I really am. When I first became a librarian 2 years ago, in a fit of endorphins and adrenaline after getting the phone call from HR with the job offer, I ran into my director's office, hey, you're stuck with me now, ha! And then ran back to my desk and mind mapped about 8 display ideas for the library using our collection. I had planned on my boss just picking 1 or 2 of them for me to do. And I mind map them using not necessarily this whole idea, but the whole, up here, LC subject area information, down here, banned books. Like, I would just write the big things, and then, okay, what do I need for banned books week? It's, I need to pull a list of all the banned books. I need to check the collection about the banned books. I need to see if ALA has any fun bookmarks or a banner we could use. You know, I did that for every display idea I came up with. And then I took the paper to my director and said, hey, these are just some ideas I have. And keep in mind, I did this all within the first 2 hours of officially being a librarian because I'm weird like that. And just hoping for approval on 1 or 2. And she shoved the paper across the desk at me and said, do them all. Yeah.
So I don't really use mind mapping. My trick is I'm a very linear thinker, but figuring out what goes first, what goes second, what goes third is actually a huge problem for me. And when Corey and I were talking about this early on in our acquaintance, she sent me something she designed. It's a project planning sheet. It is available for sale on her Etsy shop if you're into that kind of thing. Full disclosure. But it's pretty straightforward. It says, what are the steps you need to take? And it forces me to say, okay, this has to happen first. This has to happen second. It has a section for materials or special approvals I need. It has a big old section for notes, which I use a lot. So for a huge, complex LibGuide, I've been working on our religion LibGuide for quite a while. Right, it's got pages and subpages and indexing, and I have to pull in materials from all kinds of places. It's a huge, sprawling project, and it takes up about three of these project planning sheets.
Wow.
The other thing that I really use a lot is following up with people. I mentioned before that making sure that people are giving me what I need is a regular part of my to-do. And for me, that is the humble sticky note. The humble sticky note has an ongoing list of every single time I contacted this particular teacher to schedule an instruction session that they asked for, but were not getting back to me about date and time. So by the end of the post-it note, we'd played phone tag four or five different times. But this has been invaluable to me. When I'm following up with an IT issue that is long, ongoing, annoying, and nobody's getting back to me, I can say, in work order number, blah, 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 in February, I asked for this. Here's all of my follow-ups. What's going on with this project? And it's amazing how many people are like, oh, that.
Yeah.
So for me, it's easier rather than going into my email and pulling up that information just to have it all on a post-it note and stick it in my planner. When somebody doesn't get back to me immediately, the post-it note moves to the next week and they get a phone call from me every week until it's taken care of.
Wow, you're annoying.
I am annoying. It's great.
Surviving interruptions. Now, we said we are academic librarians, so we work at two different state colleges. And any other academic librarian, hell, public librarians. Actually, no, anybody, you all know what it's like to be working at your desk and all of a sudden you're interrupted. For us, it's by students, which is fine. That's part of the gig. It's what we signed up for. But you need to be able to have a project, like for me, working at the reference desk, it has to be a project that when a student walks up, I can just be going, da 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 da. How can I help you, sweetie?
Right, so having a project that's interruptible. Some projects are not interruptible. So we kind of divided these into plan to be interrupted or plan to lock the door.
Yes.
When I am recording videos for the library website, I literally write on my door, recording, please do not disturb, and tell the reference staff, unless the building is literally on fire, please don't interrupt me. And they're great about that. But if not, I can't record. Somebody will knock on my door, somebody will walk in, a student will come up with an APA issue. I have to really make sure that door is shut and that I have a zone to work on certain kinds of projects. But email or LibGuides or filling out travel forms or even putting in an order request from our purchasing department, I can do that on the desk. Mostly it's short bits. And if it's a big LibGuide, I can check things off as I go on my list. So I always know where I am.
Yep. And for me, my office-only tasks, I have recently become the acquisitions librarian for my college. So, yay. Part of the gig is doing the ordering of the books. Now, the way we do things here at my college is we have shared folders for our 10 librarians, and I have to go through these folders when I order things, make sure I know how many copies we need per thing. I have to make sure somebody hasn't accidentally added the large print edition, which, I mean, it happens to the best of us. And I have to make sure that if it's a book for our bachelor's program, that comes out of a special fund, so I have to pay for that in a different manner. So that takes a fair amount of concentration for me. I can't do that at the desk. I can add books to the folders. I can do collection development and read book reviews and go, oh, okay, we need this book for the Lakeland campus. We need this for the Winter Haven campus. Awesome. But when it comes to ordering, it's shut my door. Unless the fire alarm goes off, don't talk to me until I open my door back up. Okay, the Eisenhower Matrix, also known as the Priority Matrix. This is what I've based my prioritization method on. It is not this exact method. I'm going to show you that on the next slide. But if you haven't heard of the Eisenhower Matrix, you split things into four quadrants. Urgent and important, meaning you got to do it today. Important, not urgent, schedule time to do it. Urgent, not important, delegate it. For those of us that have minions, student workers, OPS workers, work studies, interns, etc., that's what you want to delegate. Anything that falls in there. And then not important, not urgent, stop it. Do you really need to do this? Like, think about it.
I got lucky, actually. We had a not important, not urgent thing. It was on my to-do list for like 6 months when I first started at the library, and I finally went to my boss after 6 months of never getting to this project, and I said, does this report actually need to be done for any reason? And she said, no, I guess it doesn't, and we stopped. I don't have to do it. It's glorious.
Yes. Now, this priority setting option is the one that I use for my weekends. During the week, I have a different setup because work has different priorities. But on the weekend, you remember when I said earlier in the video that I would make myself this massive list of 10 to 20 things that I needed or wanted to do? Well, after a bit of soul searching a few months ago, and doing a lot of reading on how to prioritize and learning to prioritize, because I didn't know how to prioritize. I'd been in the planner community for 3 years. I knew how to prioritize. No, I didn't. So what I came up with was five must-dos. So what are five things that I want to get done that weekend? And sometimes it's timed stuff. Sometimes it's stuff that's been sitting around for a few weeks that I just need to get it done. And sometimes it's social obligations. What are three things that I want to do? What are some projects, whether they be personal projects, crafting projects, house projects, that I just really want to do that just bring me joy? You know, those type of things. And then two. If I get these five things done, then these three things done, if I still have the energy, what are two other things that I'd like to get to, but if I don't get to them, it's not a big deal. All right? That's usually something that has been waiting around for a while. It can wait around for another week. All right? And this has really been a massive improvement for my mental health and mental clarity. And as much as I would like to try to implement it here at work, that's not going to happen because here at the college, students are our number one priority. And as much as I like to say that when I'm ordering books that no one's going to interrupt me and I'm not going to go help a student, yeah, that's a lie. If the other three librarians are busy helping students and another student needs help, I'm gonna get up and I'm gonna go help that student. So as much as I'd like to say, oh yeah, this'll all work for work, it actually doesn't, just because of how the day has to be structured.
All right, so I wanna talk a little bit about time blocking versus task-based time management. These are really the kind of two big ideas. both Corey and I tend more towards task-based.
Mm-hmm.
It's, we're going to work on this specific task, either until we reach a specific stopping point, or we just need to transition to something else because a student mm-hmm. walked up. But we tend to organize our to-dos by, we're going to work on this task until it's done or until I can't anymore. Mm-hmm. Another style that really works for some people is time blocking. I'm going to work on X project for 2 hours. Often it's, I will work on this project for 2 hours every single day. It's nice because you know how much time you have. So especially if you're a person who gets really wrapped up in what you're doing and you know you should stop working on this project and go to lunch, but you kind of don't want to, and you kind of don't want to, and you kind of don't want to, and before you know it, it's 4 o'clock in the afternoon, you got to go home and you never got lunch. Time blocking might be useful. You can literally set a timer and say, nope, when the timer goes off, I'm done with that project for the day.
Another type of time blocking is called the Pomodoro method, where you literally set a timer and you work until that timer goes off, and then you get up and you take a 5-minute break. You can Google that. I think it's also on the
references
page. Also, I know we talk a lot about in terms of work, but in terms of personal, like task list, yeah, that's your to-do list. But for time blocking, that can work for people in terms of, I'm going to spend 15 minutes a day tidying my house, or I'm going to do 3 hours of yard work on Saturday, something like that. Or for the bloggers and YouTubers out there, it's going to be Monday I'm going to film, Tuesday I'm going to edit, Wednesday I'm going to write, Thursday I'm going to take pictures. And that falls into theming your days as well as time blocking as well, because they will block out time to, I'm going to film from 8 a.m. to 12 p.m. That's a lot of videos. But
it's also really nice to use some kind of modified time blocking system when you have a huge project. Remember I mentioned I've been working on a lot of really big projects? Well, I can write them on my daily to-do list, but they're not going to get done. Instead, I have to just figure out how much time I can actually legitimately put towards this project. If it's only 20 minutes today, well, that's more time, that's more progress than I had yesterday. If it's 20 minutes the next day, great. If it's 20 minutes the day after that, I've now put an hour towards that project in little teeny tiny bites. Remember, guys, we eat an elephant
one bite at a time.
All right, now planning and planners. Corey is a print junkie.
Yes,
I am a cyborg.
I am.
Right? I have my print planner, but I also use a lot of electronic tools to keep myself organized. So you don't have to pick one or the other. You can use both. You can use just print. You can use just electronic. And we're going to kind of go over some of the stuff that we've tried.
Yeah, that Corey has tried mainly. Claire has learned from my mistakes.
It's true.
Yes, I love this quote. I just wanted a planner, but I think I accidentally joined a cult.
Yeah.
It is true. And if anybody listens to Productivity Alchemy, a recommended productivity podcast that's also linked on our references page, one of the co-hosts will regularly
start screaming, "It's a cult!"
When certain planning systems are brought up, particularly Franklin Covey.
It's a cult, guys. But there are lots of options. If you like a lot of rigidity in your structure, Franklin Covey, Daytimer, FiloFax, those are all very rigid systems that give you a lot of structure. You can also do, like both Corey and I have ended up doing, and DIY it.
Yes. Oh, God. My system ended up being a cherry-picked planning system of, I do use Franklin Covey inserts, but not the system. I have a custom-made binder, but my goal setting is from the Passion Planner.
So you can mix and match. You do not have to buy into a cult in order to use bits and pieces of the system.
No.
Corey talked a little bit about the passion planner. The really cool thing about that is it encourages you to set goals on a regular basis.
Yes, it does.
And then make regular progress towards those goals. So if getting those big goals to be part of your daily life is a hard thing, check it out. Bullet journaling. It's a very flexible system. It can be a cult.
Yes, it can
be. It can also be a Pinterest hole that you never emerge from. But it's also really flexible and usable.
And I also do use part of the bullet journal system in my system. I love the idea of collections, or as I call them, categorized to-do lists. Like, what do I need to do for my Patreon account? What do I need to do for my Etsy shop? What do I need to do for work? And while most of my work stuff stays in this, I do have a running sheet in my little one where if I think of something outside of work, let's face it, I am human. I do think about work outside of work. I will either write it on that page, or I've taken to writing it on, surprise, Post-its, so I can just slap it in my other book.
Whereas I'm more likely to put a reminder in my calendar because I have that hybrid system and my phone is pretty much always with me. Now with print planners, you've got a ton of choices. You can get dated or undated. If you're somebody who picks up and drops off planning as you need to, if it's a really calm week, you may just have a vague to-do list. Undated inserts might be perfect for you because then you can fill out weeks as you go and you don't have blank weeks where you just didn't do anything particularly. Mm-hmm. You can do the horizontal, which I'm fond of, or the vertical, which Corey prefers. You can also have daily, weekly, and monthly pages. We both use weekly layout. That seems to work about right. If you are a super busy person, a daily insert might be just right. It gives you a whole page for a single day. The emergent task planner kind of serves that for me. Or if you're somebody who mostly has a standard job and the to-do list is really easy and you don't have a ton of long-term projects, a monthly grid might be just what you need. So look at the spaces, see how much space you need, play around with it. There are tons of options. Ah, yes. So these are kind of a mix of printable and homemade. We already talked briefly about bullet journaling. There's a ton of information online and we link to some stuff at the end of our presentation. The Emergent Task Planner, which I've already talked about. And I wanted to show off this, it's called a Chronos Spiral, I believe. It's for people who don't think in straight lines. This is my roommate's, actually. She made us a sample to show off. It's a 24-hour grid that allows you to do time blocking or tracking all kinds of stuff. So there's a to-do list, and there's every color means something different. There's also a circular month planner. These are both using stencils that we link to at the end of the presentation. And if you're interested, check out Pinterest. There are a lot of really unusual circular or spiral time tracking options out there.
Okay. We would be remiss if we did not acknowledge that the fact that if you were to go on Instagram and type in hashtag planner, you would see everything. We have talked a lot about functionality, functional planners. Now, Claire uses stickers and washi tape to make hers pretty because that's what she needs to look at it. Mine, because mine's a cherry-picked system and I use colorful pre-printed inserts, I don't necessarily have to use the stickers and the washi tape. However,
there are pre-made planner sets, which Michaels, Joann's,
Hobby
Walmart,
Lobby,
everywhere now will sell you $500 worth of planning stuff. They're fun. I mean, if you really want a pretty sparkly page to list your goals and dreams, please go for
it
and do it.
We're not saying that it's wrong. It's not us.
And don't feel like you have to spend a ton of money to start planning.
You don't. Claire said, she's, what'd you say, cheapskate?
Ah, cheapskate, yeah.
She's cheapskate, which I actually prefer the term frugal. I love the fact that she, you know, designed something herself to fit her needs. I have cherry-picked my system, and I, like I said before, I do design planner inserts and sell them on Etsy. So, and I have used stickers and washi tape in the past, but don't feel like you have to do the pretty if it's not you, okay? And if you're somebody that does the pretty, more power to you. It's not us.
All right, I also want to talk about some electronic tools for planning, some of which I use, some of which I don't. A lot of us in academia already are on the Microsoft platform, so we may as well take advantage of what we already have. Mail and calendar in Outlook are hugely versatile. If you haven't explored them in a while, there's a task aspect. You can set things as reoccurring or scheduled tasks. So if you already use your calendar in Microsoft as kind of your go-to Bible, there's a lot more to it. You can link email items to calendar events. You can set up filtered folders in Outlook. So if you tend to use your Outlook as your to-do list, you can take completed things and get them out of your inbox. So it's very versatile. If you haven't explored in a while, maybe poke around a bit. Also, there is a thing called OneNote. OneNote is basically a digital binder, and it's very flexible. Some people use it, this example here is using it for a study kind of cheat sheet. It's how to diagram an electrical circuit. So they've got a video from YouTube, they've got notes, they've got little sketches, they have goals and questions, all on the same page. I know someone who uses this for event planning, right? They'll throw pictures, they'll throw videos, they'll throw links all into the page, and then they can look at it wherever they are. They're wedded to their iPad.
Nice.
Now, the only downside about iPads and OneNote is the app, the OneNote app for iPad is very limited. So if you're really into iPad, OneNote may not work for you. There are tons of other things. I personally use Habitica. Habitica is basically a role-playing game, kind of like old Dungeons and Dragons, for being productive. So you can set daily goals, you can set up habits, and you gain a little bit of XP every day that you do your daily goals. It also has a task list. This is where most of my non-work to-do items go. Right?
Nice.
And it makes me happy to earn a tiny bit of XP and a tiny bit of gold for completing a task. I can collect little critters and buy fancy hats. And if you like gamification, this may be a great option for you.
I don't like it. I like crossing things off. I like crossing things off on paper.
Now, remember, the Milk is a really powerful app, and it may be more power than you need. But if you are attached to your phone and you're looking for a to-do app, remember the Milk has some really cool features. One of them is that you can actually set up basically a GPS coordinate tagged to-do list so that as you walk into the grocery store, it will automatically pull up the grocery list.
This, I will admit, I did try Remember the Milk. But not for project planning or tasks. I actually tried to use it as like a grocery app for a while. And it also had, I think, the option on there of trying to do like a pantry inventory. It took so long to input stuff that I gave up on it. So
it's very powerful. If you like it, it's great. There are some people who swear by Remember the Milk. The other nice thing is that when you have lists, you can share them. So if you have a roommate situation or a significant other and you would like them to stop and pick up the groceries, you can send them that list right in the app, which is kind of cool. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so this slide may seem a little out there, but one thing we forgot to mention at the beginning of this presentation is this is the second go-around for us. We initially did this presentation at the Florida Library Association Annual Conference on May 24th. 24th, 2018. And at the end of that presentation, I had actually brought with me. You know, I said earlier in the video that I had tried every single planner system out there, and I still have most of them. I haven't sold them on eBay yet. And we essentially had a planner petting zoo where I brought a bunch of different binders, a bunch of different inserts. We had some printouts that you could take with you, because if there's one thing I have learned in the last 3 years of playing around with different planning systems, sometimes you just got to get your hands on it
and pet it
and see what it looks like in real life to see if you really want to use this. So, yes, we had a planner petting zoo. It was a fantastic success. We got so many questions and interest on it, the handouts. We didn't have a single handout left, I don't think.
I think we had like 3, and they ended up in my bag. But, so we're sorry we can't share that with you. If you ever run into us, we'll be happy to chat your ear off about planning an organization. But if you're curious about a planning system and you're not sure if it's for you, do a little bit of research online. As Corey mentioned, the planning community is pretty prolific.
There's at least one Facebook group for every type of system, and I'm still a part of a lot of them just because they're such a supportive community. And if you're just new to the system or you don't even know if you want to try it, just try joining the group and introducing yourself and go, hey, I'm thinking about getting this. What's some stuff that you wish you had known before you started using this? Or what do you like most about this system? And because this video is going to be linked on my YouTube channel, please feel free to leave questions below, and I will do my best to answer them for you. And if it's a question for Claire, I will make sure to get her answer and respond back to you.
Okay? And vice versa too. I'll be posting this on my channel as well. So there's also a ton of YouTube videos, not just this one, tons and tons and tons of walkthroughs and people showing how they use different stuff. So do some research, look around, see if somebody you know has the planner and you can pet it and play with it. Finally, here are some resources that we swear by or mentioned in this presentation. Productivity Alchemy is a hysterically funny podcast that covers all kinds of planning and organization. My favorite part is that they interview a lot of people, including a lot of creators, on how they stay organized.
Hitchhiker's Guide to the Plannerverse podcast. Oh, this one is fantastic. And yes, that is a legitimate pun. Episode 42 was hilarious. Alexis, also known as Miss Trenchco, she does StrangeCharm.com, where she used to just be a digital productivity tool maker, but she recently, like a couple months ago, actually had her planning system that she created, which you can buy from her as a digital download, she turned it into an actual printed planner.
Ooh.
So she not only does digital products now, but she also does printed products.
Getting Things Done by David Allen is one of the kind of original, here's how to be productive. I don't use the system, but there's some useful stuff to pull out of it if you're interested. And since we're mostly librarians here, your library probably has a copy.
The Time Management Ninja. This is a blog, and I don't necessarily follow it. I just catch it occasionally. And sometimes they have some really good tips. And even if it's just a reminder of, hey, maybe you need to take 5 minutes and instead of doing that thing, go sit down. It's great. It's not only how to get stuff done, but sometimes you need to take care of yourself. The bullet journaling system that we've talked about and mentioned several times, same as Passion Planner, they have their own respective websites, and there are a bunch of YouTube videos that will explain the system. You can see how different people are using them, and they have groups on Facebook. The Pomodoro technique that I mentioned, where you set the timer. There are some modified versions of that technique, but the traditional is you set a timer for 25 minutes. When the timer goes off, you get up and you go take a 5 minute break.
Yeah. And then I mentioned Jaden's Apple Stencils. They're A little bit pricey for stencils, but they're made of brass and they're extremely nice to use. They come in a variety of sizes. If you're interested in exploring some non-standard planner layouts, those are the best that I've found. Thank you guys so much
for
listening.
Thank you for watching.
And a big thank you to Jared, who is our tech person in the back,
yes,
who's making this happen and making,
yes,
our audio beautiful.
Yes, because the first time we filmed this, the video was great, but somehow the audio got messed up, so I can't travel without my sound guy now.
Anyway, thank you guys all for watching.
Have a nice day. Bye.